This is Charlotte coming up from Iqaluit Nunavut. My name is Kathleen Merritt and I'm from Rankin Inlet, Nunavut. If you're not sure, it's in the Canadian Arctic, near Santa Claus. We are Inuit throat singers. We come from a very cold place, so this is a nice temperature. And we're going to perform tonight some traditional Inuit throat singing, but we'd like to thank the traditional people of this territory for welcoming us onto this land, so thank you. Before we begin, I'm going to start with a piece called Springtime. And it was a piece that was written about, I met a man who is from the north, when I say north, I mean like the Arctic. And he has been living in Toronto for the last 30 years, carving and making a living down there. And so this piece is a real contrast from what it's like to live in a city in the south, and paints a picture of what home is like. So I invite you to close your eyes and to imagine the scenery that I paint for you. Toronto, surrounded by a world of personalities, walking by each other without really seeing one another, where a flock of pedestrians are moving through the sidewalks in unison, and men in business suits strike past fast malnutrition, appearing as fierce as a hawk on a mission to the land, holding up a cardboard sign reading, homeless, hungry, please help. But you can't tell from his owl-like eyes if he wants food or wine. Across the street is a circle of thug-dressed boys, off-white seagulls causing havoc, creating noise, laughing, hollering, calling out uncreatively rude phrases at passing girls with high boots and short skirts and cheaply painted faces. Well, everyone else is in a hurry to escape to their haven, running from the manipulation of the human body ravens. And all around there's desperation and suffocation and high squealing motivations, and I stand there and think, I can't wait to go home. In the springtime, I'll be cuddled with familiar sounds of children running around, aunties laughing, babies crying, and the local radio station blasting in the background of my mother's home. In the springtime, I'll spend hours racing past town, covered in the smell of the machine that'll take me to my hunting grounds. And on the tree, my tripe cheeks may grow rosy than white. My sister, Carrie, gets her palm to my face to the start of the frostbite. And outside all the noise, we've reached our destination. And I can breathe in the silence. In the springtime, where sealskin pants and raccoon eyes are the fashion, and a boy's only passion is to travel outside with the men. Television and toys are no competition to seal hunting, egg picking, and fishing. In the springtime, listening to old stories from my father to my brother, drinking tea on the land, comfortably sheltered in the igloobik, the snow house built with my very own two hands. Across the camp is the sound of the crisp cold air in every step that we take. It's music to my heart, as is the wings that the heavy winds make, and in early sunrise we wake. We give thanks for our catch of the day, show respect to its spirit as we appreciate the sacrifice that it's made, and we proceed to celebrate the return of the sun and the birds. Atatama o kauti balauna na na kupurina. Ilmi sigumi lutit. Nigrayu mi tisana vitimeni angipa. My son, close your eyes, for if you listen, the birds, they are coming home. Sigumi puma, I close my eyes. Na 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 puma, I listen. So I miss you.
Ah! have to just end the song or else we'll just go on and on and on. Do you think they're ready, Charlotte? Are you guys ready?
Yes!
Woo!
There we go!
Okay, it's really easy. Just repeat after me, okay? I'll make a simple sound. Just kidding. We'll break it down a little bit more. So as Charlotte mentioned earlier, throat singing is voice, breath, and throat together. I think Discovery Channel did a story on singers from around the world, and they noted that Inuit throat singers use a part of our throats that no other singer in the world uses. A lot of it is the use of our false vocal cords in some cases, but sometimes it's just a blend of all three. The way we say yes in Inuktitut, which is our native language, Inuktitut is the language of Inuit. Inuit means people, Inuk is singular, Inuit is people as a whole. But the way we say yes is we raise our eyebrows. I don't know if you saw that, but we do this. So raise your eyebrows for us. We're very quiet people. Yeah. Right? If you haven't noticed. And the way we say no is the squint of the nose. So don't do that with like here, but the squint of the nose like this. Can you show us? Just like that. And the more no it is, the more you can squish your nose.
No way.
Another way we say yes is in. Say it for us, in. Now let's sing it together. Easy enough, right? Okay, now say ha.
Ha.
Ha. Now say ha with just your breath. Now everybody put one arm in the air. Put it lightly on your throat and make that breath vibrate. One more time.
Yes. Wow, scary.
So we'll make those two sounds together, okay?
Thank you.
Gerald songs. It's used in the wind, in the competition song. It's used in the mosquito. So throat singing is a friendly competition between two women, traditionally. It was done as a pastime. When Inuit lived on the land, like within our grandmother's generation, the men had specific roles, and so did the women, and so did the children. And the men would go out hunting to provide for their families for days, sometimes weeks or months at a time, while the women stayed home and tended to the camp with their children. And throat singing really was just a pastime and a fun competition amongst each other. There are lullaby songs, because when you throat sing, you create vibrations. And are you gonna bring up the note just yet? Yeah? Okay. I'm going to continue to talk, because I'm really good at it. Just kidding. Well, Charlotte comes out with the amauti, which is a traditional woman's wear. And it's a coat with a pouch where we carry our babies. And so our babies sit directly on our backs, traditionally skin to skin. And when women create the vibration from the throat singing, the baby felt that vibration. And it's similar to, or at least I imagine it's similar to when the baby was in the womb, and the very kind of guttural, earthy sounds. So, and there are lullaby songs, and there are also songs that imitate sounds of nature, or interpretate sounds of nature. Aww, look at you. Who's got a baby? So this is an amauti, and if, Charlotte, if you don't mind turning around, you see here's the hood to keep baby and mother warm. But there's also a pouch. This would be for a newborn baby, where the baby fits just directly in. And there were some styles where the arm was much bigger so that the mother could move the baby from the back to the front to breastfeed, and then back from the front to the back, without ever bringing the baby out to be exposed to the cold. And so those vibrations create a soothing kind of, it soothed the baby.
It soothed the baby, yeah. Because and we still use these traditional amautis. We carry our children on our backs. And so when they're lying skin to skin on their mother's back, they can really feel the vibrations and the love and the songs from the mother.
It's a real connection. Love song? We'll sing the love song for you.
Thank you.
So these are very hot. So I'm gonna let her talk for a few minutes while I go on stage and take this on. And then we'll do some more singing. Sound good?
Traditionally, they were made out of seal skin or caribou skin. Inuit, we are very, we come from a hunting culture. And so you might notice the sealskin wristbands on my arms. It's very much a part of who we are. But Inuit, when they lived nomadically on the land, and again, this is like two generations ago, my grandmother's generation lived out on the land. My mother's oldest siblings had a pet polar bear. Really, like that's for real. But we still hunt. We come from a very isolated place where you can only fly in and fly out. And so when it comes to fruits and vegetables and all kinds of fresh produce, we don't get that. We get produce that is overpriced and often rotten. It's just a reality of the north, and you get used to it. But once you start eating seal meat and caribou meat and fish, Arctic char is our favorite, then realize that you don't actually need fruits or vegetables. There's enough nutrition within the meat. We also have berries and other wonderful things from the land. She has a wardrobe malfunction. Just kidding, Charlotte, I love you.
But I have a very loud voice, so it's okay!
But look at this, sealskin. We are very, very proud of wearing the seal that we eat because Inuit not only hunt the animals, but we also wear them. And we use every single part of that animal. Yeah, we don't waste any part of it. And we never over hunt, we never over harvest. So for all you animal activists, just kidding. I'm not gonna make enemies tonight, but yeah, I'm just kidding. But it is really much a reality. If you think about the North, we are very isolated, and so we do depend on the meat that comes from the land and from the waters.
You ready to sing another song?
Yeah, I am. As I said, throat singing, it imitates or interprets sounds of nature. And if you're ever up north in the Arctic, we have a lot of mosquitoes.
We don't have a lot of bugs with all the legs and the wings that you guys, bugs have, but we do have mosquitoes.
Yeah. So if you're ever like in the south, well, like southern Canada, and you see like a kind of native person in the city, and they're screaming like, like making a big fuss, and you don't know what they're making a fuss about. They're likely Inuit, and it's probably a bug. We're afraid of bugs.
So we have a song about mosquitoes.
I'm
back time immemorial. We don't even know how long Inuit have been throat singing. For all we know, Inuit have been throat singing since the Big Bang. there are some songs that are very traditional, very old, and the song that we're about to do is one of the oldest songs that we know of as throat singers. It's called Chimmerolobik, and in our language of Inuit, Chimmerolobik means dog. And dogs are very important to our culture because they were our mode of transportation. They were also our protectors. They were a part of our family. They were not just pets. So
they warned us when polar bears were around. Really, they still do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they're very smart about the ice. They know when the ice is too thin to run over, to transport over. So as young girls, they usually get the responsibility of taking care of pups to help them grow into mothers, into nurturers. So they would take care of the little pups of litters. And this song was made by a little girl who had a favorite little pup. But this pup was the runt of the litter. This pup was weak and small, and it was a pushover, but that was her favorite puppy. And she hoped that maybe one day this puppy would grow big and strong and become the leader of the dog team one of these days. And so she would sing this song to encourage her puppy and to motivate her puppy and to love her puppy and to just never give up.
Nomadically on the land, and as Charlotte said, the dog team was our way of transportation. Oftentimes, or sometimes, you would go through times of starvation where there wasn't a lot of animals to hunt. And in those times, if there was an elder, for example, who was not doing well and who couldn't contribute to the camp, they would voluntarily say, "Leave me behind as you move forward." And so I heard within the story that little runt of the litter wouldn't have survived if that little girl didn't take care, extra care of that puppy. And so she composed a song to encourage that puppy to lead the dog team one day. And if you listen, you can maybe hear the panting of the dog team running on the ice. This is Qamaniq.
I'm gonna
have been having vertigo all day. I feel like I'm falling. I have lost my balance several times because I'm not used to being so high up. Where I originally come from, it's called Idyllwild, and it's a small island. If you look at a map of America and you just look right at the top and where all of those islands are broken up, my family originates from one of those very tiny islands way at the top of the world. And it's very flat. There are no trees. There are no bushes. You can see the horizon as far as I can see. You can almost see, like, down. And when you look this way and you just go 360 degrees all the way around, all you see is sky. It's absolutely beautiful. It's so dark in the wintertime. We have 24 hours of darkness. Between mid-November to mid-January, we do not see the sun at all. It's very dark, it's very cold, it's very quiet, but this is where my family comes from. And I have these memories of looking up to the sky, and it is just a blanket of stars. As far as the eye can see, I can see more stars than I can see land because it's so flat. So I have these lovely, beautiful memories of wanting to be up there. And so this is a piece that I wrote. It's called How Lucky We Are. And it's just an expression of in words as best as I can about how much I would just love to be up there. How lucky we are to have eyes that see the sky. How blessed we can be with the infinite imagination of what those skies behold. I look away from the road and lights above them with desire not to care where that road leads me, so that I can look up to the sky and see how much the moon lights up the night, and admire the stars that bestow upon me, the ones that I can see. Wishful thinking, wishful wishing, that I can maybe one day see all the stars my night behold. If one thing I can ask, if it's one thing for me, and I'll be happy if it's the only thing I ever see, is to be with the stars, every one of them, from my feet on the ground to the eyes I have to see. Please, oh please, let me see all the stars tonight. Yeah.
do a very old traditional song. It doesn't even have a name. And then we want to open it up to questions, because I know we came a very long distance. And if you're curious, we're happy to answer any questions that you
have. Or if you would like to come up and take your microphone and try to sing.
And to try to sing, yes. We invite that very much. By the way, I have to tell you about Charlotte and her group. We just demonstrated traditional throat singing for you. But Charlotte and I both perform in separate groups together. Charlotte, do you want to tell me what you do?
So we're both contemporary throat singers as well as traditional throat singers. We started off as traditional throat singers and then we moved forward with our art and our expressions. And so we're each in our own bands. The band that I sing with is called Sila and Rise. Sila means you know, I'm very long-winded, so I'm just going to tell you. Sila, S-I-L-L-A, Sila, and Rise. If you want to look us up on Facebook, on YouTube, on iTunes, on Spotify, we're there. So we do dance music, we do electronic music. We like to call it alien hip-hop because it's something that you've never heard before. So if you just like feel like getting tranced out and going somewhere else, check out Sila and Rise. I have another throat singing partner, her name is Cynthia Petula, and then we've got a DJ who mixes beats while we sing. And then Kathleen also has her own band.
I do. And we're IVA, which is I-V-A. And we mix Inuit throat singing, spoken word, and sing singing with what I like to call Celtic-influenced folk music. Yeah, so folk, really folk music. We've got the banjo and the fiddle and everything else.
Really great.
So my father comes from Cape Breton Island, which is the east coast of Canada. My mother's from the north, so it's really a mix of the two sounds from both cultures. And I have CDs for sale. So, if you care to buy a CD, it's got really great artwork and really cool music.
And you would not be disappointed.
All right, so we'll do one more traditional song for you.
We have to talk through it.
Thank you.
questions. Yes, maybe I will go out.
We'll take turns.
Okay. We're good friends. What's your question?
So when I heard about the baby being close to the skin and the vibration of songs, do you think that the origin of bonding came from women, mothers bonding together with the men around?
Yes,
absolutely. Any woman in this room can tell you. I'm just kidding.
Yes, there's, you know, throat singing is, it is a competition, but it's also something very spiritual, and it's something that really connects. As you can see, Kathleen and I have a very strong connection. It connects us to each other, it connects us to the spirit world, it connects us to our families, it bonds us with our children. It also keeps us warm where we're cold. When we're singing, we're breathing in and out, and it elevates our body temperatures. When we get close to each other, when we're holding each other, there's that human contact and that warmth. So it's definitely very holistic. Yes.
Are the sounds that you're making in any way related to your Inuit language, or are they just sounds?
There are.
Hi.
So they're all just sounds. The one song that we did called Qamaniq is the only song that I know that has words. So Qamaniq, and we said. So that sound, I don't know if you guys can hear the similarities between Qamaniq and. And then Amiakwapik means leftover. And then Mamak means yummy. So this poor little dog always gets the leftovers, but it's always yummy.
And actually, in Uptiduk, we use various parts of our mouth and our throat. So we, anything from, say, B, P-I-B, D, G, like K-I, K, R, N, so say C, and Asu, she could back to the time. We both use three of So, say sing,
ing,
so when you say ing, hold your mouth exactly where it ends, ing, ing, and that means sing in Inuktitut.
Any other questions?
The back.
I'll do the front.
By the way, I walked up the hill yesterday, and I was so out of breath. What is going on here? Alright, question?
Hi, first off, thank you so much for coming here to sing for us. I'm absolutely privileged to hear this you sing. I was wondering how much strain this puts on your throat, and how long you're able to perform. And if there are any special precautions you have to take to protect your vocal cords.
Yeah, so if you're doing it wrong, you can harm your throat and your vocal cords. However, when you do it right, it's like learning to play the guitar. You know how you callus your fingers when you play the guitar? We don't quite callus our throats. It sounds kind of gross, but it's similar to that. You build muscles within your throat. And so when you're singing properly, you don't actually, it has absolutely no effect on your vocal cords.
It's just like
seeing
someone out of context.
Like drink lots of water.
Hi. I hate to say this, but we arrived very late. Would you do an encore of something? Please?
Sure.
Our time limit? Because I feel like we're going.
It can be short.
I can't say no.
Okay, you know what? I'm going to be very, very real with you. We'll do you that favor if you do me a favor. How many of you guys pray?
Yeah.
To whatever, yeah. All right, even if you don't pray to any certain God, just put some really, really good vibes out there, because my dad's in the hospital tonight. And so if you could just do that for me, we'll sing you the song. I know, babe.
Thank you.